Enviro Close-Up is made possible in part by a grant from Greensphere.
Women's Environment and Development Organization. We do next on Enviro Close-Up. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I am Carl Grossman with June Zeitlin, who is the Executive Director of the Women's Environment and Development Organization, We Do. June, what's We Do?
Well, We Do really exemplifies our organization, which was founded by the former Congresswoman Bella Abzug about 10 years ago around the Earth Summit in Rio. And what We Do at We Do is try to bring women together from around the world, develop a common agenda, and then try to influence governments at international meetings convened by the United Nations and others to make sure that women's voices and concerns are taken into account. And in particular, we're concerned with making sure women's voices and women's needs are considered when we talk about global economic decision making and economic justice, around sustainable development, and around governance. We really are concerned that too few women, both in this country and around the world, are at the table when decisions are made. And so we're trying to promote more women and women with a progressive agenda in decision making.
I was in attendance at the UN Conference on Women in Beijing in 1995. In fact, I met the late Bella Abzug there. And I recall literature put out by the United Nations then about the low representation of women in government throughout the world. That was 1995. Have things changed?
Well, in 1995, women represented about 10% of all members of legislatures, of parliaments, of congresses around the world. Now, in 2002, women represent about 14%. That's not much change. It's about 0.5% or so a year. And it's very clear to us that unless some additional measures are taken, unless real political will is mobilized, it's going to be a century before women are represented in proportion to our share of the population, which is over 50%. And in recognition of that and of the path-breaking work that people like Bella, our founder, and other women who helped found We Do from different parts of the world, we launched a campaign actually in the United Nations in 2000 at the Beijing Plus Five UN conference. We called it the 50-50 campaign, Get the Balance Right. And what we're suggesting or urging is that governments all over the world must adopt special measures in order to increase the representation of women. We know that this strategy works. Back in 1995 at the Beijing conference, there were a couple of countries you could point to where women were close to a critical mass, 30%. But they were all in Scandinavia, Sweden, Norway, Denmark. They're definitely the path breakers. But everybody could say, well, those countries are different. They're different from us. They can do it, but we can't. And what we've seen since then, although the overall numbers haven't changed much, there's some really inspiring examples from different parts of the world. Let me tell you about a couple of those. One is South Africa. South Africa had about 9% representation of women back in the early 90s. And after the change of government, the end of apartheid in South Africa, women organized and said, this government has to change. It has to change so that the black majority is represented, but it also has to change so that women are represented. And women across all the different political parties, all the different races, banded together and went to the Constitutional Convention and said, we must have greater representation of women. And the parties agreed at that time to set aside 30% of the seats for women. And in the course of less than 5 years, they went from the 9% to the 30%. And that's where South Africa is today. It's one of the top 10 countries with representation of women at the national level. And now they're trying to replicate the same strategy at the local level. So they've now launched their own 50-50 campaign to have more women represented locally. In India, they started at the local level rather than the national level. They were opening up a whole new level of local government. It's called the panchayat in India, and it's the most local form of government, like our village or town council. And new members were going to be elected throughout the country, and they set aside 30% of the council seats for women. People were skeptical. They said, oh, women don't want to run, they're not prepared, it'll just be the wives of officials. And there were some problems in the beginning. But it's amazing. 1 million women have come into local government in India, and groups have worked with them to build their capacity, to give them the skills to be effective and to make a difference. And now what we're starting to see is that those women are taking the lead in pushing for service projects for the community so that they have clean water, better roads, better skills. The women are making a difference at the local level. And now they're trying to push to get the same 30% target at the national level. In this country, women represent about 14% at the national level in the Congress. That's about the global average. In this great democracy that we're trying to export around the world, women are not represented adequately at all. And we do, working with other women's groups here in the United States, have been thinking about how can we make a major change. Women have increased incrementally in their representation. When I worked for Bella Abzug when she was in the Congress, I think women were at the 9 or 10% level, and it slowly inched up. But again, very, very slowly. And of course, in this country, to talk about quotas or set aside or affirmative action, we know is extremely controversial and at this point not a very effective strategy. But quite frankly, in every country that's been successful, they've used some kind of targets or set-asides or incentives in order to reach that 30%. It's not just happening of its own, because people, men and probably women too, don't voluntarily give up power. So unless there's some serious intervention, it won't change. And I think one country that maybe is more similar to the United States that we can look to for an example is France. France, up until very recently, women were under 10% of the elected representatives. And they decided that that was just unacceptable. And they amended their constitution to require parité, which is a French word for parity. And I'm not sure what the exact English translation is or what the comparable strategy has been, but since the passage of that law, women have gone to over 40% representation at the local level, and the national elections will be held shortly. And they actually tried previously to enact affirmative action measures that were struck down because they didn't want to accept affirmative action. But parité, they believe, is different. It's just a matter of fairness, of having each sex represented. And at a meeting recently, I heard the French ambassador to the United Nations talking about parité, and he said, in France, we don't believe in evolution, we believe in revolution, and that's what parité is.
In this country, in the United States, should we, could we do something similar?
I think we have to. We have to create incentives either through the political parties to have a system where maybe one man and one woman run. It's something they've done in Namibia. They call it the zebra system. Or have extra campaign resources given to parties if they nominate women. I mean, there are ways to do it, to create positive incentives that would push women forward in a much more significant numbers than they are now, because in our elections, 99% of the incumbents get reelected. And so if women are fewer of the incumbents, it's just going to take forever. So I think there are creative strategies like using campaign funds, using the political parties, that would not be quotas, but would actually be positive incentives to make that change.
Why does it make a difference? Why, when women are allowed through the door and there is a change, I mean, this isn't just a numbers game, change happens. Why?
Thank you for that question, because it is really important to talk not only about numbers, but about the policy difference that women can make. Sure, we want to be there to be adequately represented, but most importantly, we want to be there because women have a different life experience, and it's this experience that they bring and the perspective that women bring to issues of the day. Women are not monolithic. We don't all have the same view. But we have had a different life experience than many men. And it's that experience that isn't present unless women are there to talk about it. And research has shown that on issues of social policy, of education, childcare, family matters, women, more often than men, will take the lead in pushing those concerns because they know what these concerns mean to people at the community level and know the difference that policies can make in terms of lives of ordinary men and women. Women want to make change not just for women, not just for themselves, but for all of society, to make it a better society. And in other countries like South Africa and in India, as I mentioned, and certainly if you look at the Nordic countries, it's not coincidental that they have very extensive social welfare policies and that social concerns are high on their agenda, as are environmental concerns. And on the issues of war and peace, women often bring a different voice and a different perspective to the table. So that's really what we're seeking, is women making social change through decision making.
Let's get to two of these issues, bigger than just issues, but two of these areas, sustainability, the environmental area, and then let's jump to the matter of violence and war. Sustainability, that's one of your biggest areas of activity. Define, if you would, perhaps, sustainability and how WEDO works in that area.
The whole issue of sustainability, or sustainable development as it's called in many places, is a very comprehensive and multifaceted approach to our development in terms of society. When we talk about sustainable development, it doesn't just mean environment, or as often it's equated, but we really see sustainability as linking environment, the economy, and social development. And we really see it as a critical paradigm shift. That was the promise 10 years ago when world leaders and WEDO and lots of organizations gathered in Rio at the Earth Summit and came up with Agenda 21. And the idea was to talk about sustainability in the future. When you think about economic growth, to think not only of growth, not only of profit, but what does it mean for sustainability of our society and the betterment of our society. Unfortunately, in the 10 years since then, globalization has just wiped off much discussion or consideration of sustainable development and other concerns. We focused only on economic growth as if that were the only engine of change. I think now most would agree, even those who have been promoting globalization and economic growth, that that alone is not sufficient in order to achieve the kind of development we want for society or sustainability, because the gaps among rich and poor, people, nations, have grown enormously, and there's a consensus that there must be some correction. And we believe sustainable development is an alternative paradigm. It's based on economic growth, but looking at how to allocate the benefits of that growth in a much more equitable way, to look at social concerns, to look at the impact on the environment, and to take that into account when you're developing economic policies. And that's the kind of sustainable development work that WEDO works on. In fact, we've just been working with women around the world to develop a new vision for the next decade. It's called Women's Action Agenda for a Healthy and Peaceful Planet. And we have five themes under that: peace and human rights, globalization for sustainability, access to land and other resources, environmental security and health, and governance. We think those are all elements of sustainability and sustainable development. And we're hoping that the rest of the world will catch up to that view, and also that we can have a conversation in this country about what that means and how we begin to link economic, social, and environmental goals together. Because I think in this country, in a way, our conversation has lagged behind the conversation in other countries, particularly in Europe, where there's a much greater understanding and much greater political will to look at the economy in terms of its environmental and social costs and try to come up with another way to do business.
And then to the not unrelated area of violence and war and women being, well, the chief victims of both.
Yeah, this is obviously a very timely and important subject, and one which, in a way, voices have been hard to hear as the world rallies around the campaign against terrorism, and in this country, the real hurt that we've experienced. But the issues of violence are really permeating our society and our ability to respond to social needs. The amount of money that's spent on military and defense needs is about $800 billion globally a year. And of course, the United States is spending enormous sums. And one of the things we need to look at is the balance between allocating funds for human needs and human security, as well as the military. And for a long time, issues relating to violence against women were seen as something separate. Oh, it's a, you know, domestic violence, with the emphasis on domestic and not so much on violence. And I think one of the things that the women's movement, both in the United States and globally, has achieved since the Beijing conference is a real recognition that violence against women is just an extensive, universal problem. And it's violence that happens in the home, it's violence that happens in the street, it's violence that happens against women and civilian populations in times of war, it's violence against women as refugees, that in every type of armed conflict, women are often the hidden victims. And now we're trying to make that not so hidden and to deal with it. But actually, the first sentence in our women's action agenda is that ending violence is a prerequisite for sustainability. We've got to find ways to prevent violence. We've got to find ways to talk to one another. In all of the different conflicts that we face in the world, it's often women in the community level, women in Israel, in Palestine, who try to come together to talk to one another. In fact, I've heard women say, you know, we're willing to go into a room and sit there for as long as it takes and to keep talking until we can find a way out of this. And I think in Africa and Rwanda, in many situations, it's the women at the community level who will take the risk to try to sit down and talk. Unfortunately, when it gets to the national official negotiating table, the women aren't in the room.
Years pass very quickly, and perhaps some young people viewing this video aren't too familiar with Bella Abzug. You were very familiar with Bella Abzug. You were long associated with her. Can you talk about Bella?
Bella Abzug was an amazing figure here in this country, and I would just say a very important mentor to me throughout my career. Bella was trained as a labor lawyer, and her signature here in the U.S. was that she always wore a hat, and people wanted to know why was Bella wearing a hat? Was that just some kind of gimmick for the media? And actually, the story as she tells it is when she graduated from Columbia Law School in the 1940s and she went to a labor law firm, there weren't too many women lawyers. And in fact, she was always asked to bring the coffee and as if she were the secretary and not the lawyer. And so at that time, in order to distinguish herself as a professional woman, she started wearing a hat. And that became her trademark when many years later she ran for the Congress in the early 1970s. The poster was Bella with a hat and said, "This woman belongs in the House of Representatives." Bella was an activist for many years before she became a member of Congress. In fact, she founded Women's Strike for Peace in the 50s when women were very concerned about the, this also probably dates me and dates you, but when there was above ground testing of atomic weapons in the United States, and we were very concerned about fallout in the atmosphere and getting into cow's milk. And so it was really women around the country and around the world who were demonstrating against the nuclear testing. And women organized at the community level into an organization that was called Women's Strike for Peace. And they were very forceful advocates for the nuclear test ban treaties. And that was really the beginning of Bella's public career. And after that, she began to organize women, not just around peace, but as part of the second generation of the women's movement in the early 70s. And with Gloria Steinem and Betty Friedan and the founders of NOW, helped to found all of the women's organizations of the early 70s. And finally, she herself was convinced that while she could be effective on the outside, we also needed women in public office. And so, like I said, she ran for the House of Representatives in 1970 and was elected to the Congress. And it's amazing, she served only 3 terms, 6 years, but in that time, she became one of the most influential members of the Congress. She ran both on an anti-war and a pro-woman, pro-progressive policy. And I remember one of her stories about getting elected in 1970, and the president then was Richard Nixon, and she had gotten elected on an anti-war platform. And with all of the other freshman Congress men and women, she was invited to the White House. And Bella was someone who wouldn't mince words. She always told you what she thought very directly. And she was standing on the receiving line waiting for her turn, and it was finally her turn, and the president shakes her hand thinking, and then she would just move on. And not Bella, though. She stood there and she said, "I want you to know, Mr. President, I was elected by my constituents to end the war in Vietnam, and that's what I'm going to do." And she was talking on and on. In the meantime, they're like trying to move her out of the line. And the next day, she introduced actually the first impeachment resolution of Nixon in the Congress. I had the opportunity to work for her in the Congress. I was a young lawyer. I was one of her legislative aides, and I worked on her women's rights and civil rights legislation. And I have to say, I've worked for a lot of people since then, but Bella was the only boss I ever had who sent things back to say, "This isn't strong enough. Can you take a stronger position?" Little did I know at that time how unusual that would be. But I think the thing that was most unique about Bella was she had an amazing ability to see what was needed in terms of leadership and what the next set of issues that would be a way to mobilize social movements. Because she was involved, as I said, in the peace movement. She was a founder of the women's movement. And then she also became very active in the environmental movement and sustainable development. And she was one of the first women leaders to say, women have something to offer here and we need to organize herself. And also, she was one of the first American women to understand the connections to the global women's movement and the fact that we women in America have a lot to learn as well as to give our sisters all over the world. And so I see Bella as not just the leader of one movement, but the leader of many movements. And today, as we look at the many issues that we face, it's that kind of outspoken leadership, leadership of principle, that we really are sorely lacking. And sometimes I feel like she's speaking to me, and I wish I could speak in the voice that she spoke in, but nobody really could do that the way Bella did. And I hope for those of you, especially young women and young men too, who are students in college and university, whether you've taken a women's studies course or not, we'll learn a little bit more about her life, because it really shows you the difference that somebody with determination and commitment and passion.
We Do became her central emphasis, really, for
The last 10, 12 years of her life. She really brought the skills and the knowledge that she had learned in the Congress of the United States and in all the work she had done in these other social movements to the global arena. Before Bella organized WeDo and brought women's voices to the UN, the UN had had NGOs and other organizations involved since its inception, but it was always in a very refined and polite way. And not that Bella was not refined or polite, she was all of those things, but she also was there to achieve an outcome. And so the skills that she had learned in the Congress about mobilizing on the outside, bringing your ideas and almost your legislation, your amendments, lobbying techniques, were all things that she brought into the UN for the benefit of women, but for the benefit of all society. And now it's quite ironic, because the things that she had to fight for and really open the doors for are taken for granted at the UN now. In fact, the role of civil society, the role of advocacy, the role of lobbying governments is expected at the United Nations. And really, Bella was the architect of that and really helped bring together women from the United States and North America with women from other parts of the world. And that, too, is the legacy that at WeDo we try to continue to carry on.
People watching this who would like to get involved with WeDo, I mean, how does it work in terms of the organization and people out there? How can they link up?
Well, we have a website. Right now it's down, but it will be functioning again. It's www.wedo.org, and there's a lot of good information on that about what we're doing, how you can help be an effective advocate, good materials. And the women that we work with around the world keep imploring us to speak out more strongly and mobilize the women's constituency here to influence the foreign policy of the Bush administration. Because it's really at the United Nations, in the International Criminal Court, where we can work together to achieve our common aims. And if we're asking the rest of the world to support us on our agenda here in the United States, we should be also supporting an agenda that will end human rights abuses everywhere, that will begin to address poverty around the world, begin to address the AIDS crisis. We can't hold back and be so stingy, because the United States is stingy in our development assistance, despite our large economy and a lot of our rhetoric. We give proportionately, of all the industrialized countries, the least amount of development aid for poverty. And so, and part of the reason is members of Congress and the administration think Americans don't care. We don't think that. We think Americans do care, and we know that women care. But you have to speak up and let people know that you are concerned about that. So we want to point you in some of those directions.
They care, and they do. And you should, too. The phone number, and also your address.
Okay. Our address is 355 Lexington Avenue, New York, New York, 10017. Our phone is 212-973-0325.
The name of the organization is Women's Environment and Development Organization. You've been hearing from June Zeitlin, who she is the Executive Director. I'm Carl Grossman. This has been Enviro Close Up. Thank you for watching, and for information about other Enviro video shows, just check out our website at www.envirovideo.com. Thank you.